recently, and we have people from different backgrounds, different ages, generations, different thinking patterns. These are some of the variables of diversity that are established by the Society for Human Resource Management. And each of these variables has a distinct effect on how people can collaborate in a team and how well can we get to do that. And we know that we have to create or foster a culture, organizational culture. It may not necessarily be the culture that is around us. And we have talked about that numerous times. We thought we were the culture that they wanted, but then we saw that we were like a microculture or a counterculture. And then we sat down and asked ourselves, what is our ideal organizational culture? What changes are needed to get there? What do we need to start doing? What do we need to stop doing? Because part of the learning process is stop doing unlearning. We have to unlearn some things. And we have sat down. I think we do that every day after the day ends. We sit the two academic directors, we were digging in and we start thinking what happened in the day. And we start looking at what we need to do. And we learned during that process that disruptions, right, changes in the organizational culture, they get kind of done like a guerrilla inside of academia, because we're trying to push boundaries and try to do things differently. The way we approach the classroom, the way we approach working as teams, the way we work on, with online environments. Usually, at least in Puerto Rico, when you have an online instructor, he becomes like a tutor and has a content that he has to work, he or she has to work with, but we encourage them to create something new. You don't like it, just change it, and we foster that kind of accountability and that involvement from the professor. And thinking and acting differently eventually catches on. We're hoping that our model or how we're doing things will eventually get to other departments and say, well, this is something we can do. It will lead to different results because it's different people, different leaders, and different structures, etc. But we think that something could catch on eventually. And although not without pitfalls, because we have many along the way, but the thing is, like, what did we learn from this experience and then take it to the next effort we made? So we also have a very different approach to leadership. Like I said, I'm not very fan of the concept of leadership, because I think it's been misconstrued in so many ways. But we said that leadership needs to be dispersed. I'm not the only one that needs to be making decisions. We have to make decisions as a team. Sometimes I have to make like decisions of the team, and sometimes the dean has to make the decisions. But when we can do it together, maybe it could lead into great avenues of discovery. Also, the leader at the center of action and transformation, if we're gonna promote something within our faculty, us at the top should start doing it ourselves. Followership is leadership, and then leadership and followership are complementary. Following, some people are going to lead, some others are going to follow. So we sat down and asked ourselves, how will we define leadership and how we will foster it? And then what we learned is that leading and following not only require knowing how to do things, or knowing how to lead or how to follow, but also the willingness to learn. Many people forget about that. You know, you have to be willing to change, you have to be willing to try new things. And that's something we all have also learned. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the department. This is our team. I really like this team I work with every day. It's just one of the joys of getting paid to work with people you like and doing things you like. And we have people from different disciplines, radiology, marketing, human resources, education, English, instructional technology, religion and history and math, entrepreneurship, education, Spanish, math, finance, accounting, logistics. So you get the idea of how diverse we are, and we come from different educational backgrounds, right? So that sets how we approach the learning process and the teaching process. And in terms of how we do things in the department, usually a faculty member traditionally gets a number of courses that are part of this workload. But what we do is combine the workload. Usually it's face-to-face, even though they are ascribed to the online department, we like to foster they still remain and teach online face-to-face courses, and then online courses, and always, for most of the times, we assign them a project that needs to be completed during the semester. Sometimes it's a design of a course, sometimes it's a creation of student resources, and we're going to present one of the major projects we have been working in the English that my colleague will present a little bit later on. And then we approach like project management. Every semester, the professor that gets assigned a project, he or she receives a brief and then explaining what we're expecting from that person and what are the terms, what we want to see by the end of the semester. And we always provide the resources, the monetary or the human resources needed for that faculty member to get that project completed. And we meet occasionally. We started, we just only have one departmental meeting during the semester, one at the beginning and one at the end, that's it. The rest of the times we meet like according to projects. Because why would we need to get together if we're just gonna talk about things that could be discussed over email? And then we use transdisciplinary and participatory collaboration. We use Outlook groups. We use communities of practice. We have an area on Blackboard that we're all faculty members that teach online courses adjunct and full time. There and can ask questions, and we're trying to set up like a faculty mentorship program. We have instant messaging. Instant message with Blackboard Collaborate, Blackboard IM, the entire day, and we get a lot done through a simple messenger. And then I always need to be a facilitator. I just can't expect things from my faculty without helping them get what I'm asking them to do. And then the department should be an incubator for innovation. We should start looking at what we can do. And then we have different priorities that we have established as group. And those are that are related to the quality of our online program, chart integrity, innovation, research, internationalization. This is an institutional project, and that's a really complex project because we have to define what's internationalization for our institution, how we're gonna work it, and it includes curriculum, it includes how we're gonna train and develop our faculty, how we're gonna attract foreign students, and then communication, clear and constant communication, always a frame within training and development. We offer around 100 workshops per year, per academic year, both face-to-face or little webinars that are offered throughout the year, and have an excess of training and development in different areas. And then always evaluation and assessment. In terms of faculty development, we always place, at least during the past few years, we have emphasized on curricular design, pedagogy, and communication in international context. Then we have this event called PFI, which has two meetings, one at the beginning of August. This last semester, in August, we have like different people, speakers come and speak about different topics related to education, technology, instructional technology. But this time, this last meeting we had in August, we said, you know, we need to turn things around. I think things are grim, are looking grim, are difficult, and we need to approach those difficult times are approaching with a new perspective. So we brought a team called Seriously Creative, which they are specialized in system design thinking. So we had our faculty had a brainstorming and creativity workshop for the entire day. It was really fun. At first we thought that our faculty members wouldn't get up and, you know, and start doing with tables and doing what they were being asked, but they really had a blast, and it happened to be one of our best conference we have. And then in April we meet to discuss best practices in a way that we are doing right now in distance learning, and this is an activity that we open to the rest of the system and to other institutions as well, and the workshop that I already talked about. And we also require, and it's now mandatory since August, that every professor that teaches or designs an online course is certified with a specific certification the university provides or offers, which is focuses on designing courses and on teaching online courses. And now we're gonna establish where our colleague here, Marcos, who's always, Dr. Torres here is always figuring out the statistics and doing the, assessing how effective we have been with our efforts. And then in terms of evaluation processes, we evaluate the faculty, the full-time faculty, both the ones that are ascribed to the department, the ones that are ascribed to other departments, and they're evaluated by students, by myself, by their peers, and then they do an audio evaluation. And then with the adjunct faculty, I think it's, how many adjunct faculty we evaluated this semester?
More than 20.
More than 20?
My group did eight, there were three groups.
Yes, because we distributed the workload between different groups, and because we were worried about what's happening inside those courses, you know, there's, we need to ensure that there's being, that our program is up to the higher standards, and we don't see the evaluation process as something punitive, but we want to see it as a process of how helping our colleagues grow as online educators. We also evaluate the administrative staff. They are evaluated by the dean and by themselves and by their peers. We instituted something that the deanship of administration had instituted internally, which is peer-to-peer evaluation. And we thought that the dean and I thought that we should be evaluated as well by the faculty members. How well are we doing it? So although we go about through the same process of evaluation as the other faculty members, we also ask our faculty members to evaluate how well we were doing our job. And then I get evaluated by the dean and by the other associate dean and the dean, and then the dean gets evaluated by the chancellor. And a little bit of the projects that I've been working and that I will be continued working in terms of academic, we're two of our Spanish professors are working on a guide to internationalization of language, as you may know. Those who are speak Spanish might seem like it's really simple, but it's really complicated in terms of like my word for, our word for cake is not the same word in Mexico, and probably is very offensive. So we're trying to create this guide that allows the professor and the student to understand the differences in cultures, because we have students from Mexico, we have students from Panama, from Venezuela, and we need our we need to raise that cultural awareness in our students and our faculty members. We're also working the assessment of online learning, so we can improve it, and we eventually want to go through the accreditation process. But to go through that process, we need to have everything in order and make sure that it's up to the highest standards, and we want to extend, we're working on faculty mentorship. For example, every time I hire an adjunct professor in English, I have them meet with one of the faculty members in that discipline, so he or she knows what is